Assalamu alaikum. Welcome to the Munir Muhammad Show. I'm your host, Jamil Muhammad, and we are streaming live. If you'd like to participate in today's conversation, please give us a call at 773-434-6625. Brothers and sisters, we have a very exciting show for you today. But before I introduce our guests, I want to remind you, as always, please follow us on our social media platforms, which include Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. And go to our YouTube page, click the subscribe button so you can be notified whenever we post a show. And brothers and sisters, I'd be remiss if I did not extend a happy Father's Day wish to all the fathers out there in the world. I hope that you enjoy this day designed to be celebratory for us, but every day is Father's Day, brothers and sisters, so continue to do the work that you do. I am very excited about my first guest. She is the host of the Black Excellence Hour. She is a urban conservative radio host, our sister P. Ray. Welcome to the show.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
I'm so excited to have you on. I've heard a lot about you, so it's wonderful to have the opportunity to sit down with you.
Thank you for inviting me.
Thank you. So before we get into the show, I want to give you an opportunity just to tell a little bit about yourself and the show that you host and some of the things that you're involved in.
So I am a product of the Austin community. Okay. I am West Side to my core. Uncle Remus all day. I am also a graduate of the Chicago Public Schools. I am a graduate of Whitney M. Young Magnet High School, as well as an alum of Hampton University in Hampton, Virginia, where I majored in finance. I also hold a master's degree in language, literacy, and culture from UIC. And so my path has been a little curved in a way, because I live my life internationally. So in 2010, I had the opportunity to travel to West Africa in Senegal, and I opened a school called ICRA Bilingual Academy. ICRA Bilingual Academy is West Africa's first and only Islamic international bilingual school with an American curriculum. We are accredited by the U.S. Department of Education, so our diplomas are American high school diplomas, which then allow our children to go around the world and get into various universities. We cater specifically to Islamic diplomats, Senegalese business people, and people within the diaspora. And so that experience opened my eyes to what Black life is, because I got to see Black people in a Black country and thriving. It's they don't have a culture of doom and gloom that's promoted on us. And so what it does is it propels the society to become better for everybody, and it keeps the society very peaceful. So when I went to Dakar, I brought back a lot of those cultural treasures, and I wanted to start to implement them within my own community. And so in 2016, I left the country again in protest of Barack Obama and Rahm Emanuel. I have a had a four-year-old, now she's nine. I got a passport for her downtown at the passport office, and we left. We went back to Dakar. And while I was there, I was able to once again build a very international network, a very high level international network. And it really ignited my passion to create federal change rather than change within my West Side community. So when I came back to the States, I happened to be on a blog in the middle of the night, and they said that they were having a coon fest, no, a sunken place coon festival. And I was like, what is this? So I clicked the link, and I saw that Ben Carson was going to be at this event. And so I said to myself, okay, I'm going to apply to go to this event so that I can talk to Ben Carson about the fact that the city of Chicago is very actively and rapidly demolishing middle-class Black Chicago, like they demolished lower-class Black Chicago by demolishing CHA. The Chicago Housing Authority received $500 million from the federal government to rebuild those structures, and they hoarded that money for over 20 years, causing chaos throughout the city. And that was a very calculated move. So I applied to go to this festival. I get an invitation the next day from the White House, and it says, The President of the United States requests your presence in the East Room. Please RSVP with Secret Service. So I RSVP, I go to DC, I walk into the White House and have a very direct conversation with Ben Carson, just like this. I said, Dr. Carson, you're the reason that I'm here. I am here because this administration talks a lot of trash about my city, but you, sir, have all the power to save us. Because if you can compel the city of Chicago to spend the federal housing money, we can take care of ourselves. We are a resilient people. We come from Mississippi cotton pickers. There's nobody tougher than us. Right. However, when we are dealing with a system that is hoarding resources from us, it's very difficult for us to advance. He said, Patricia, you are correct. What we are going to do is we are going to get rid of that aldermanic prerogative in your city. The aldermanic prerogative allows the aldermen to veto any developments that they do not want in their ward. So that encourages housing discrimination. That encourages housing segregation. So once we get rid of that, the city will spend the money, and then you will see that our administration was successful. Also, our goal is to move people out of Section 8, which is housing, and into Section 3, which is businesses. So just give us a moment. We're going to do our job. I said, no problem. The president got on the stage and gave the best speech I have ever heard in my life. And I was like, USA, you know, Team Trump, put my red hat on. You sold me. So I came back to the city and I wanted to explain this to the people in my network. I grew up in a way as a princess in the Chicago black political machine. My parents were hyperactive in this. This is why I do this so well, because this was our family's extracurricular activity. So I go back to our groups. I call the radio stations. I go to different organizations. I'm like, I just came back from the White House. I got great news. And they were like, don't want to hear that. We don't want anything to do with Trump. And I'm like, he's a sitting president with all this power. How dare we like not want to engage him as if we have so much power? And they didn't want to hear me. So then I got into this circle of other black conservatives led by Candace Owens. Now, I'm not Candace. Candace has her merit. Okay, Candace uses the access that she has, and she brought everybody in. So that, aside from what comes out of her mouth, that we do not like. We have big issues within our clique about how she communicates at times. But what she did do is she got in, and instead of her closing the door, she threw the ladder over the wall and said, everybody climb up. So now we have this national network of people from Seattle to Miami, itty bitty Mississippi. Everybody was there. And we were not tokens. We were not, you know, nobody paid us to be there. We were just black people in America who were very serious about making changes in our community. And so, again, nobody wanted to hear what I had to say. So I happened to be listening to WVON one afternoon, and a lady said, this is going to be my last day. I'm going to move to Sundays or Saturdays. So I called the station that Monday and I said, what's up with that spot? And they were like, you can get it. You're P-Ray. You know, we've been hearing about you. You call in all the time, because a WVON host invited me on her show with the intention of humiliating me because I was a black Trump supporter. But I was able to articulate our platform so great that she said, you know what, you're right. I see why you like it. And then the people on the station became interested, and now I have the hottest show on the station, Black Excellence Hour.
Let me ask you this, because I love that that story in your path, and I do know that a couple of things that you said that impact our community to its detriment is that we do with the former sitting president, you know, we're not in a position to say we're not meeting with anyone when we don't have any leverage. And that people could say, well, we had our vote and now we have someone else elected. But you can look at what you're receiving.
Anyway, gas is up $1.20.
So
thanks, Biden voters.
So with that, and then when you say conservative, because when you really get down into the policies, especially as it applies to family and business, many black families historically have been more on the conservative side. But the narrative now is if you say it, you're just automatically alienated. And so it's interesting that even within our community, we're not allowed to have conversation or even healthy debate and dialogue about mm-hmm. a subject. And now I want to go back to I want to talk about the school, but also when you said you left the country in protest of mm-hmm. former President Barack Obama mm-hmm. and Rahm Emanuel.
Yes.
And that's another hot button topic. I'm a follower of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad. I measure results mm-hmm. of what was actually accomplished, not what was professed, not the emotional symbolism of mm-hmm. things. And so I found that when you measure the results and even want to talk about Barack Obama's presidency, that our people shut down.
Well, it's interesting because we have suffered, black people suffered the most under under President Obama. The only time we did worse was during President Rutherford B. Hayes's administration, which was 1880, and he closed down the Freedmen's Bureau and ended Reconstruction. So then that's what ushered in state-sponsored terrorism, okay? Mm-hmm. That was terrible for us. Barack Hussein Obama, from 1863 to 2016, all of the wealth that we gained, we lost 70% of it. 70% of our wealth is now gone. You know, and it took us over 100 years to get it. And nobody is outraged about this because we want to have his picture on the wall and we want to talk about how good it made us feel. And it's not up to the government to nurture your self-esteem. And I think that we have to stop looking at these leaders as nurturers of our self-esteem. That comes in the home. When it comes down to your elected officials, it's about, like you said, the results, mm-hmm. because this is America. And the only way that communities are able to prosper through government assistance or government resources is through their representatives that they're sending to that government body. Mm-hmm. And if those representatives are not producing the results that the community needs, then we need a different rep. Yeah. You know, it's just as plain and simple as that. But people fall in love with personality. And then this is why we keep sending the same representatives to keep making the same bad deals, which then give us the results that we have now.
And it's always an excuse. Mm-hmm. It's always we're able to identify one person as the boogeyman or the individual that's preventing us from our collective gains.
Correct.
And it's just a cycle. So but I want to talk about you said so many diverse things, but why a school? What made you start a school in Senegal?
So it's, I went there too as a founding teacher. Right. Uh-huh. The woman who, so my parents, when I graduated from Hampton, they were like, you're going to be a lawyer. Mm-hmm. And I was like, I don't want to be a lawyer. And they were like, you're good at it. You can do it. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to law school. And it was just a really bad time because when I graduated from Hampton, and Hampton is a country club HBCU. It's mm-hmm. very, very bougie, very, very traditional, mm-hmm. old South mm-hmm. school. Mm-hmm. I came back to the city. My first cousin was murdered on a Chicago sidewalk less than a month after I got home. So to go from horses and sailboats and crab cakes to Chicago realness was mm-hmm. too much for me. And I wasn't comfortable in that law school space at that time. Right. So I happened to be on Facebook in my contracts class, and a girl who went to Whitney Young with me posted, my friend is opening a school in Africa. Anybody who wants to go, let me know. So I inboxed her. I'm like, what's to it? Tell me about it. She's like, it's going to be a bilingual Islamic school in Senegal. And I said, wait a minute. Mm-hmm. I'm not French. I don't speak French. Senegal's a Francophone country. I'm not Muslim. Mm-hmm. I'm a happy Baptist. Mm-hmm. I don't know about all this. Right. And she's like, girl, come on. It's just like the West Side without the threat of violence. Everything you love about the West Side is in Senegal. So I left. You know, I did my Skype interview. They sent me $1,000 and I ran off into the abyss. I could have been running into some, you know, arranged marriage situation. I don't know. But it just so happened that the school, the woman who built the school is from Brooklyn, New York. And she also ran away to Africa in 1994 with no plan, met a guy, married him 10 days later. Now he's a doctor. They have 7 kids and they're living off their dreams. So being around her and seeing the results of running into the sun and what that looks like, I ran into the sun with her. And not only did I get experience with teaching the children, but I got experience with dealing with the African upper class or the international upper class, because there are more than African children who go to our school. There's a whole expatriate community in the mm-hmm. world. Okay. So I got to really ingrain myself into that, which is what helped me change mm-hmm. my mind.
Mm-hmm. Let me ask you, okay, so you're back in the States.
Yes.
You start your show on VON. The time when I know it had to get a lot of attention, but I'm sure people were just questioning you, just throwing things at you all the time. And so, you know, and I will say this, being a follower and student of the Most Honored Elijah Muhammad, growing up in a situation where people always asked us a lot of questions, but did not necessarily respond if we asked them questions. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure that you get that a lot. And so, what do you think is the biggest misnomer about Black conservatives?
That we are being funded by white conservatives.
Okay.
White Republicans are not giving us any money. Mm-hmm. White Republicans are not giving us any money. I pay for my show out of my pocket. Okay, because I have a finance degree. So yeah. I work in banking. I'm a licensed stockbroker as well. Mm-hmm. So I use my salary that I'm getting from the firm to pay Melody Span Cooper.
Yes.
You understand me? But people think that I have these sponsors and I go to these meetings and they're throwing all this money at my feet and now I'm reading this script. Very similar to what Candace does. You know, we know that Candace is a multimillionaire based off the things that she says out of her mouth.
Yes.
But Candace is not funding her own way.
Right.
I fund my own way. That's the most important misnomer that I want everybody to understand, because the Black conservatives, we are Black, period. We're talking about Black stuff. We want our check, cut the reparations check. That's totally divergent from that white message.
Right.
You understand?
Right.
So all of that, because we are not lockstep in what they're doing, they do share, they do help. I do get small sponsorships every now and then, but nobody, I shouldn't say no one, but I don't make my living off of doing this radio show. It actually cost me out of my pocket over $1,000 a month, almost $2,000 a month.
Yes. Okay. Now with that, as well, when you have the perception, this blind loyalty to not only the Democratic Party, but I think when you talk about liberal views overall, it's now so much that when you look at, we've lost our objectivity for everything, and especially in the media. So if you look at MSNBC, even CNN is over there now. I mean, it's just heavily slanted. And so, do you feel that your show presents a balance where at least people can begin to understand the less? And this is another thing. It's made to seem like conservatives are a small number, but they are a significant number of people who feel that way.
The president, my Donnie, that's what I call him on my show. Okay. My Donnie got a 30% increase in the Black vote in 2020 than he got in 2016. So the movement is growing very rapidly, and it's growing because we're tired of being told that we're pitiful. We're not pitiful people. Mm-hmm. We're not a charity of the DNC, of the Democratic National Convention. Mm-hmm. We don't need them to tell us what to do. We don't need them to tell us how to think. And I think what's really pushing Black people red right now is the forced homosexual culture that they're pushing on us. We accept everybody. You know, they like to have this notion that Black people are so homophobic, but we have gay men directing our choirs at church. We have gay men doing our hair. We have lesbian women watching our kids. You understand? So we always have dealt with that culture in our community in our way.
Yes.
But because this liberal media keeps telling us that we are homophobic, we keep saying, no, we ain't, look. So now we've accepted everything.
And it's heavily over-promoted.
Mm-hmm.
Every show you watch, Black people have now become the face
of
the LGBT community when you look at it. And I mean, you can't have a traditional Black family structure on television.
No.
And so, and you're right, it's forced not only at an earlier age in our students is that you're villainized for even promoting a traditional sense or even some kind of balance.
That's my point. So we're sick of that. We are sick of that. We are not against LGBT, but we are not interested in your sexual behaviors. Mm-hmm. Because the base of the LGBT movement is sexuality. Okay, mm-hmm. It is sex, and that's your business.
Yeah.
So that's the first thing. The second thing is the illegal immigration here in this city. Our neighborhoods are rapidly changing, and they're changing because the city of Chicago is a sanctuary city. So that means that the city of Chicago has decided that a certain group of people will not be federally prosecuted for breaking federal crimes. But you and me both know people who hit that PPP scam, right? Mm-hmm. All of them going to jail without beyond a shadow of a doubt. If you stole that PPP money, you are going to jail, federal prison. But there's no sanctuary for that. You know, Lori Lightfoot didn't say everybody who did the PPP scam, all of you all, we're going to all hang out in Inglewood. And if you are in these Inglewood borders, we're not going to let the feds come get you.
Right.
No. But in the city of Chicago, they're not helping ICE. The state does not help ICE. So now you have people who have immunity to federal crime. That's not fair. So this is what's starting to push people our way as well, because we're saying, how is it that our people picked all this cotton in this country, but we let people walk in, get the same stuff that we have, even more than us, and now we're protecting them from federal prosecution? It can't work.
But what do you say? I mean, the federal government, the mayor, the governor, they just gave you a holiday. Shouldn't you be satisfied with Juneteenth?
Let me tell you this. So my Donnie came up with the Platinum Plan. And in the Platinum Plan, one of the objectives of the Platinum Plan was to make Juneteenth a holiday. So Juneteenth was going to be a holiday, whether my Donnie won or if we gave it to Joe. This was still going to happen. So I don't even look at that as a success, because this was just a natural progression. I think that we all can understand that is, you know, nominal. Mm-hmm. And so now it's time for us to seriously have a real conversation about our money, because the United States government does not hesitate to cut checks to the state of Israel at all. Mm-hmm. You understand? We give them billions, hundreds of billions of dollars every single year. Mm-hmm. And there's no debate about that.
Right.
But we've been playing with H.R. 40 for the past 31 years. So now they passed it, and now they're going to get permission to do the study about reparations. Stop playing with us. Cut the check. You don't need permission to study. You didn't need permission to cut a $1.9 trillion stimulus package. Right. You guys got that done like this. So we are allowing them to play with us. And this is why the liberal class is so nervous about people like me telling my people, no, this is not good enough. Let's use our political capital in other ways.
The Democratic Party, of course, has taken our people for granted for years.
Yes.
Right now, we have the Democrats have the majority in both houses, have a sitting president, and now the representative from the state of West Virginia, he's going to be villainized as that person to hold everything up. That's going to be the latest excuse. But when you go back to Donald Trump, and I'll say this, the way the narrative and our people discuss him, you would have thought that the murder of black people, racism started with Donald Trump.
Mm-hmm.
The police were killing people under previous administrations, and this doesn't make it right, but I'm saying that he became the face of racism and injustice towards black people when the history states that it's been going on before then. And so I know that's by design, but how can a people fall asleep so much that they just buy into that?
This is what the media did. Because, okay, I was out of the country during the 2016 campaign.
Mm-hmm.
So I got to watch this election from an international perspective, rather a very biased local domestic perspective. Mm-hmm. This is how the liberal media did it. Mm-hmm. MSNBC and CNN were both Barack Obama fan stations, okay?
Mm-hmm.
You had Melissa Perry, Joy Reid, what's the man named? Sharpton.
What's the lady with the Caucasian lady with the short
hair? Tracy Maddow, Rachel Maddow, all of them, right?
Right?
So black people got in the habit of watching those stations to get their Barack Obama fix for the day.
Mm-hmm.
So then the message of those stations switched and it made Donald Trump a hypervillain. Mm-hmm. And because that was where they got all of their information from, Donald Trump became the hypervillain in their lives. So they never talk about the good things that my Donnie did. My Donnie permanently funded HBCUs. Mm-hmm. My college president, Dr. William Harvey, who has been the president of Hampton University for over 40 years, said that this is the best funding package he has ever seen in his life for HBCUs. Mm-hmm. Now, what Omarosa did was, mm-hmm. and they talked bad about Omarosa, but she was highly effective. Mm-hmm. She got the president to move the HBCU budget out of Congress where it languished under Barack Obama. Mm-hmm. We lost three HBCUs while Barack Obama was in office, mm-hmm. okay? Mm-hmm. It languished for years. They did not take it seriously. She convinced my Donnie to move it from Congress into the White House budget as a line item because Congress does not debate the White House budget. Right. And so now HBCUs are permanently funded. They did not talk about that. Mm-hmm. They also did not talk about the fact that my Donnie signed police reform on June 16th, 2020, right after the death of George Floyd. Mm-hmm. He outlawed the chokeholds. Mm-hmm. He said that they were going to give more federal money to the local municipalities to help them with their training. I mean, mm-hmm. there was a plethora of police reform. They never talked about that. Mm-hmm. Instead, they want to show you the man dying over and over again to hurt your self-esteem. Their goal is to hurt our self-esteem and make us feel low because the low people are a controlled people. But an empowered people are a free people. And we know that the Democrats are the party of the slave master. Okay, we can never forget that the Democrats fought in the Civil War to keep us enslaved. And so rather than having us being physically enslaved, now we're mentally enslaved. So we believe that we cannot function at all without the charity of the government. And if we try to step out of that box in any way, we're going to be confronted by a racist boogeyman who's going to bite our noses off, you know. And it's just not true. This is our country. We've been here the longest. We are the only people other than the natives who are not immigrants to this country. We are emancipated Americans. And so when I'm having these conversations with my white counterparts, they're like, well, I don't like how you talk about blackness all the time. I'm like, you need to mind your business because this is an emancipated conversation and you're not emancipated. We have our own relationship with the U.S. government and we have to stand on that.
Okay. Before we take a break, I want to go to the line. We have a caller. Caller, you're on the air. Go ahead with your question or comment.
Assalamu alaikum, Brother Jamil.
Wa alaikum salam, Sister Martha.
And greetings to your guest. She is on fire.
Thank you.
Oh my God. I didn't want to even interrupt. Mm-hmm. Let me ask this question. You all are now talking about federal government. Let me ask the mayor, when Donald Trump offered to send troops and just kind of some type of help for the crime, carjacking and everything in the city of Chicago, that was shunned upon. Now, all of a sudden, the mayor is now reaching out to the new administration, asking for the same thing that they were going to give them a year ago. Can you give me your opinion on that? Thank you.
Thank you, Sister Martin.
Yes, ma'am. So this is what happened. Lori played a trick. I like Lori. I like Lori a lot. But Lori played a trick. Mm-hmm. And Lori has, like I said, been lockstep with Donnie the entire time. But because she's getting this funding from the DNC, she has to read from that DNC script that all of the black female mayors are reading from. This is what Lori did. The fans have been here since last summer. Mm-hmm. Remember when they were down at the Columbus statue downtown and they mm-hmm. were like throwing firecrackers at the police and all that stuff? Well, my Donnie passed a law that said that the feds can be brought in to protect statues, right? Mm-hmm. The night before the feds got here, Lori pulled down 100% of the Columbus statues in this city. There are no statues of Columbus standing right now. Mm-hmm. So when the feds arrived, she sent them to the south and west sides, and that's why carjacking is now being prosecuted as a federal crime. Mm-hmm. But Lori could not stand in front of the camera and say, I am going to work with the Trump administration to bring federal help because Trump was a social pariah. Mm-hmm. So she had to work around that. Just like she'll never give the president credit for helping her get rid of that automatic prerogative. You can't strip all that power from the Chicago City Council and not end up in the river without federal help. Right. And she has always been doing that. Now, because it's safe to say out loud, now she's saying send federal help, but she's already had it here.
Mm-hmm. How do you... And outside of the media painting it, you know, Joe Biden.
Who really I call him Jim Crow Joe.
has it. You know what? Before we get on that, I'll tell you what. Let's take a break, and then we'll come back and start fresh with that conversation. Brother and sister, we're going to take a quick break, and we're going to come back on the other side with more interesting conversation. We'll be right back.
Run Chicken and Fish has the only chicken you can reheat and eat. It's good as mother's and better than the others. It is the chicken even mothers love. We've been serving the community for over 30 years. We cook with 100% vegetable oil and are open 7 days a week, including holidays. We're located at 87th and Hermitage. Contact us at 773-429-1812 for your takeout order, or let us provide all your catering needs. For the best chicken of your life, it's Eat and Run.
You are watching The Muneer Muhammad Show, a production of CRO. Please take time to join us at CRO, the Coalition for the Remembrance of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. CRO is the National Archive of the Nation of Islam and houses one of the largest collections of historical audio, video, and print documentation on the total black experience. CRO is located at 2435 West 71st Street, the corner of 71st and CRO Lane. We are open 7 days a week, 9 to 5. Our number, 773-925-1600. We look forward to seeing you at CRO.
Assalamu alaikum, brothers and sisters. We are back continuing our conversation with P. Ray. Remember, this is a live call-in show. If you have a question or comment, don't wait till the last 5 minutes of the show, brothers and sisters. If you have a question or comment, 773-434-6625. Before we go to Biden, why do you go by P. Ray?
So, so I'm named after both of my parents, the P and Ray. I'm their first child, born on their fifth wedding anniversary. So they named me after the both of them. But as I told you, we are the machine. You know what I'm saying? Right. So I'm rogue.
Right.
And my mom is like, I don't want them mixing up the names. No.
Right.
So we pulled her off the marquee, and now I go by P. Ray.
Gotcha. Okay. So it's safe to say your dad's name is Ray.
Yes.
Okay. Now, we're going to get into President Joe Biden, who this transformation. Now, his political history is really, he's been there for longevity, but really hasn't accomplished much, especially in the way of black people. However, he's been reinvented. And so talk about that transformation and the reality of what we should expect versus this picture that's been painted.
The liberal media decided that Biden was going to be the president. Okay. The reason that they did this is because my Donnie got rid of the war machine. While he was president, we did not start any new wars. He was actually bringing the troops home. And we know that the United States of America makes its money through wars. We are a war hawk country. I say, how much war could a war hawk hawk if a war hawk could hawk war? And Jim Crow Joe is a war hawk. So they had to create this new image of him. They went, they got Kamala, you know, mm-hmm. here we go, you know, somebody who was blackish, mm-hmm. you know, they use that whole AKA thing. I'm a financial AKA, mm-hmm. and I'm like, I don't pay dues for this. You know what I'm saying? Right, right. But they use our mm-hmm. everything about black women. They mm-hmm. use black women to reinvent Joe Biden, which is disgusting to me.
So you weren't taking pictures with Converse?
Oh, no, I did not put on no Chucks, no pearls. I did not. I put on my Make the Hood Great shirt again. Mm-hmm. Make the Hood Great shirt again. Went to the polling place, voted for Donald Trump, stood outside my polling place with a Trump flag and was telling people walking down Chicago Avenue, get in there and go vote for Donald Trump. And the guys were like, thank you, Shorty. I appreciate that. I should go vote for Trump. Yeah. Which is why, again, not that my little precinct made it happen, but my people were doing this all over the city. Yeah. You know, we were proud Trump supporters. With all that being said, this is what we can expect from Jim Crow Joe. Mm-hmm. Jim Crow Joe has been in office. This is his 48th year working in the federal government as a legislator. Let's talk about what he has said. He said that all of the criminal sentencing policies in the Senate have come across the desk of the senator from Delaware with his full support. Y'all going to jail. Because Donnie let everybody out. You remember? He was closing the prisons. Yeah. Jim Crow Joe said, back to the jails you all go. The way that they're going to do it is through this PPP fraud. Mm-hmm. We can also expect to lose significantly more of our wealth. Like I said, Barack Obama, we lost 70% of it. I think Jim Crow Joe was coming to sweep up the last 30% plus a little bit more. We could be in a deficit as a people because inflation is already through the roof. And we already know that based upon us coming out of that that financial mishap with Barack Obama, we were kind of building ourselves back up with Donnie. Jim Crow Joe is about to take all of that away. Okay. So we can expect that. We can also expect a surge of illegal immigration, especially here in the city of Chicago. The city of Chicago, if you do not know, is the headquarters of the Mexican drug cartel in the United States of America. Time Magazine wrote an expose about this in 2014 that shared on the Black Excellence Hours page. But what they did was they chose Chicago specifically because all roads in the country lead to Chicago. The fact that we're a sanctuary city and the high black male unemployment. So that creates the perfect workforce for an international terrorist organization such as that. So we should also expect to see more terrorist attacks domestically in this country because Jim Crow Joe has opened the border. And what they show us in this liberal media are children and mothers and kids. But these are not the only people coming across the border. Anybody who can get to that southern border can come over that southern border. They have caught Iranians. They have caught Syrians. They have caught all types of people down here at the border that they are not talking about. And it makes you and me, or me and you, excuse me, more... it's more dangerous for us because our city has put this magnet, you know, down mm-hmm. and said, if you're here illegally, everybody comes to Chicago and we don't know what that's going to attract.
Okay. You know, I want to talk about that more, but we have a caller. So I'm going to go to the line. Caller, you're on the air. Go ahead with your question or comment.
Well, I just have a comment. This is Karen Hicks from A Few Good Women. I just want to tell everybody that's tuned in. This young queen right here, she's speaking truth. She's teaching black excellence, and it is time that many of us listen and get involved. She's teaching. The young people are not doing the habitual, traditional, and ritual way that we were trained and programmed to do. I love you, Queen. Keep on speaking truth and facts and waking us up, because we've been asleep and we've been dead. Love you. Love you for doing this show, too. Have a great day. I'm going to continue to listen.
Thank you.
You know, I think one of the things that resonates with me that you said was stop depending upon the government and this doom and gloom kind of thing, because we've seen people make careers out of restating mm-hmm. problems in the black community. We've seen elected officials, we both grew up in Chicago, we're close to elected officials. Every campaign, the promise is what? Better education, more jobs, better neighborhood. Mm-hmm. Same line. You know, the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad taught us to do for self, pool our resources, make your own communities a better place to live in, and take, you know, really qualify yourself for independence. Mm-hmm. And one of the things to look at is that, you know, a lot of the programs that we become dependent on are not designed for us to become independent.
Correct.
You know, and so it's just maintaining that same thing. And so what do we have to look at as a people? And then when we look at our elected officials, in actually drafting legislation that's targeted for this, we've had heard about reparations for the longest. Okay. Mm-hmm. There are bills that languish in committees that never come to vote. There are things, ultimately, when President Biden got in, you know, I was very surprised that with all of this groundswell of movement, you come off of the incidents, of course, with George Floyd, and all of the things that happened, there was no discussion of reparations on the national level, mm-hmm. which I would have thought would have been the most opportune time, mm-hmm. especially with the perceived relationships the Democrats have with our people. So, I mean, is this finally the reality check for many of our people?
I think so. Mm-hmm. So my Donnie put $500 billion on the table called the Platinum Plan, mm-hmm. which was a very targeted and specific plan of to increase the stature of Black America, not mm-hmm. only in this country, but in this world. Okay. Mm-hmm. Our people walked away from $500 billion for $1,200 stimulus checks. Okay. Mm-hmm. And those $1,200 stimulus checks caused inflation to go through the roof. And now we are paying almost $4 for gas.
Yes.
Okay.
And that's one thing. Hold on. Mm-hmm. I paid $85 filling up in my to come here today. And I'm going to just tell you, ever since right after the election, gas has been up and no one is talking about it.
I talk about this every week on the Black Excellence Hour because I'm like, why did y'all do this? Y'all did this so you could take pictures with your outfit on and say, oh, I voted in Orange Man Bad. I would take Trump's mean tweets every day with some $2 gas, okay? Yeah. Give it all back. So this is why we're moving into this movement to turn Chicago red so that we can get my Donnie back in office and he can kind of sweep all of this up. But what we need to do is take a very analytical look at our issues. So I'll give you an example. Mm-hmm. Right now in the state of Illinois, Black literacy for eighth grade students reading proficiently has been 15%. That means 85% of Black students in this state are not reading at a proficient level. Mm-hmm. And so what this liberal government keeps saying is, well, give them more money, give them more money, give them more money. No, we don't need any more money. What we need are ESL based classes. So aside from me working at the bank, what I do is I'm a literacy consultant as well.
Okay.
And so I worked out in District 88, which is Maywood, Broadview, mm-hmm. Bellwood. And I saw that the Mexican children were doing better on these standardized tests than the Black children. Mm-hmm. And I said, how could this be? They're not even speaking English at the house.
Right.
Let me tell you why. Black children, Black people, us, we speak Ebonics. Mm-hmm. Ebonics is a English translation of Wolof. I mean, it's grammatically the same. This is how I was able to pick up Wolof. Wolof is the local language of Senegal.
Okay.
So I was able to pick up Wolof very fast. I'm like, oh, we're speaking like this at home.
Okay.
So I'll give you an example. If you said my head be hurting. And Wolof, that's summer boat be meti. Summer my boat head be meti hurting. Summer boat be meti, my head be hurting.
All right.
If you don't learn the word be is or are, and they put that on the test, if they put an Ebonics answer on the test, if you speak Ebonics, you're going to choose that Ebonics answer because they purposely put it on the test to throw you off. And so then we get back these results that say that, you know, 85% of us cannot read. So instead of throwing money at the problem, we have to retool the curriculum. So as I am interviewing these Republican gubernatorial candidates on my show, I always push this literacy program for Black people because I know Black people who say, I don't talk to white people because they act like they don't know what I'm saying. Mm-hmm. But they don't know what you're saying. So right. when I was going to UIC, I gave this presentation called ain't a verb, Yes, yes it is. Mm-hmm. And we talked about how ain't is a helping and a linking verb and how you as educators have to teach Black children that the word ain't is to be or are not. And depending, or it could be no. If you say, come on, let's go to the stove, ain't, that means no. Right. Or the fact that Black children are not being communicated to properly. So Black children at home are told, sit down, don't touch that, go to bed, you know, commands. When they get to the classroom, those teachers say, can you please stop? Can you please sit down? You know, and the child will say, no. And now you're being insubordinate, but you ask that baby a yes or no question. You're not communicating with them properly. So when they talk about on the Republican side being so anti-critical race theory, I think that we have to think about how we as the people can use critical race theory, understand how as emancipated people, we are very different than the mainstream America and start to tool programs to specifically deal with us. Not people of color, not Black and brown, not none of that. Yeah. The Negro people. Period. We need Negro policy. Right. And if we start to develop Negro policy, and a lot of people don't like the word Negro, so I'll say emancipated policy, Freedmen policy, like we have the Freedmen's Bureau. Right. Reopen the Freedmen's Bureau. It's simple. The Indians still have the Office of the Interior. How did we lose ours? Because of Rutherford B. Hayes. So now Jim Crow Joe, if you want me to stop calling you Jim Crow Joe, reopen the Freedmen's Bureau and help my people directly.
All right, hold on, we have another caller. Caller, you on the air. Go ahead with your question or comment.
Yes, sir. Assalamu alaikum, brother.
Wa alaikum salam.
Yeah, this brother Fatah. I just want to say this sister right here, P. Ray, she is a threat to the male chauvinist that's out here in our community. And you're familiar with Sister Ava Muhammad within the Nation of Islam. Whenever we have a strong Black woman, we as Black men should support our women, regardless if we don't agree with their political affiliation. So I just wanted to say, Sister P. Ray, we support you.
Thank you.
We love you. And we want you to continue on doing what you're doing. May you be successful. That's really all I got to say. Don't keep teaching.
Yes, sir, brother. Thank you.
Thank
brother.
You.
You know. I love your passion and more importantly the truth. And you know, you mentioned interviewing Republican gubernatorial candidates, and J.B. Pritzker, I mean, during his campaign he was in Chicago all the time, all the churches, many of you know, and even though you know, I'm on the west side all the time, born on the west side, raised on the south side, but most of my time is spent on the west side. You know, that Uncle Remus Harold's debate, will, you know, we'll talk about that later. But I know he was over there after the election. There's nothing. But when you look at the states that are most financially strong, they're Republican.
Yes, they
states.
Are.
And, you know, and so what I'm saying by that is that at some point you have to look at the results and the formula. I mean, regardless of the emotional pull that you have to look and say, well, why is that? You know, and so the state, like on the state, there's Chicago and there's everything else, you know, in the state of Illinois. So it's not outlandish that you may have a Republican gubernatorial, you know, governor. Now, in the city of Chicago, that would be, you know, historical on the Republican side. But when you look at, and based on that, when you look at the city of Chicago itself, what would it take politically to shift into a more open style of leadership?
We have to start having these conversations out loud. So, for instance, last night I did a Juneteenth ball for a fundraiser for my show. A lot of people bought tickets, but a lot of people did not come because they don't want to be on camera with someone like me who calls the president my Donnie. Yes. You understand me? Right. So people are very closeted in their beliefs. So our goal is to create an environment for people to be able to stand up and say, well, you know what? I do agree with you. Let's talk about how I agree with you and how we can move this around. But right now, because people are so anxious to be accepted, they just say whatever has to go along to get along. That's the first thing. The second thing is we got to get the Black intellectual class together.
Yeah.
I'm talking about my peers, okay? Because a lot of times when people talk about the Black intellectual class, they'll say, well, you just saying that because you didn't go to college. I graduated from college twice. I am in a sorority. I live this glitterati lifestyle, okay? Right. The Black intellectual class because there are two things happening. Number one, it is very disconnected from the Black community. And so the connect that the Black intellectual class has to the Black community takes place on social media. Mm-hmm. And because the Black intellectual class is at a higher literacy level, they hold on to these liberal views and espouse them as if these are the opinions of Black America. Mm-hmm. And then everybody else says, oh, well, Black folks doing this, I got to be on point because, you know, we got to follow the tribe. Right. So we have to start qualifying our leaders beyond the fact that they have college degrees. Mm-hmm. I'll give you an example. Jemele Hill. Mm-hmm. She was on, what was that? ESPN. Right. And now she's a social justice warrior. Mm-hmm. I had a direct contact to Jemele through a guy I went to Hampton with. And my Donnie talked about the coyotes who were bringing the kids over. Mm-hmm. She, because she did not understand what a coyote meant, she thought it was like Wile E. Coyote. Mm-hmm. And she was like making all these jokes. Oh, he's so stupid. He's talking about coyotes. So I wrote my contact a message to her and I told him to tell her to be quiet. Mm-hmm. You are embarrassing Black women and mm-hmm. this is a embarrassment to Black journalism. Yeah. How dare you not know what a coyote is in the middle of an immigration crisis? Right. You know, be quiet. You talk talking too loud with too big of a platform to be playing with people emotionally like this. Mm-hmm. He blocked me, but I bet she got that message. You understand? Okay. So we, as Black intellectuals, we have to break away from this liberal acceptance. Since we want to be accepted so bad because we, you know, we were nerds. You know,
they're afraid they're going to be canceled.
And who cares? Can't nobody, it's 8 billion people on the planet.
Well, you know,
how many people try to cancel me? When I started Black Chicago for Trump, I had a Trump sign in my yard on the West Side.
I understand. Hold on. We have a caller within the last 5 minutes. Caller, go ahead with your question or comment.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam, brother.
Good evening, or good afternoon, or good morning to you. I have a bitter taste in my mouth about some of the WBON personalities in the past who espoused the conservative view, particularly Charles Butler and the other one, Abdul Shabazz. They talk so paternalistic to us as though we're dumb and stupid and we don't know our rear end from our elbows. So listening to you has kind of allowed me to have a refrain from the way I think. I find you more palatable. And maybe I'll listen a little more to your show.
Oh, praise
God. God bless both of y'all.
Yes, well, but that's the beauty of the show and the conversation, because, you know, you have your platform, and I appreciate you coming to ours as well. Thank you for that, because our people need information. Mm-hmm. And we have to leverage our platforms to allow our people, you, to talk directly to our community. But it's unfiltered. And so I appreciate that, because you are very relatable. What you say makes sense. And I think if we're honest with each other, we can find the value in that. I think we have one more caller. Caller, you're on the air. Go ahead.
Hey, good evening. Good morning. Good morning. This is T.C. McCoy.
Hey, T.C.
Hey, now, I really enjoy mm-hmm. listening to this young lady talk. You know, a lot of times we don't have to agree with everything everybody say. I just want us to agree with majority of everything of everybody say. And this young lady made some very fine points. But again, when you start talking about platforms, I have to go back to your father, Munir,
yes,
who gave me an opportunity to get on the air to air my differences, even though it wasn't popular at that time. Yes, so, you know, just by allowing people to come on and having different views, show that we as a people have different views with each other, and we can all mend together because we have one common objective, and that is to help our people get where we got to go. Yes, so I just wanted to say thank you for allowing me this opportunity to call in and listen to this fantastic show, and this young lady, keep doing what you're doing.
Thank you.
Thank you. Well, sister, we're coming to an end of this hour, but, you know, we'll have to do it again soon. But for those who want to get in touch with you, find out more about your show, how can they How can they follow you? Tell about when your show airs. Go ahead.
So my show is Sundays at 5 p.m. Mm-hmm. on WVON. Mm-hmm. You can follow me on Facebook at Black Excellence Hour. Mm-hmm. That's our page. You can also message me through that page. Mm-hmm. I'm always online. I'm always in these black groups. On Facebook, my name is P. Ray Ease, EASE-LEE. I have to spell it phonetically because mm-hmm. I got a bank job. Mm-hmm. People will call my job and try mm-hmm. to make me lose my money. But this is how you follow me. I'm out here. I'm very vocal about the fact that I really want us to experience change, because our grandparents, when they came up here from Mississippi with nothing, they stood on their feet and built us a world to enjoy in the city of Chicago. And we have allowed liberals to trick us out of that by telling us that it's worthless. And now they're bringing in, begging people to come here and right. take our spot.
You know, and next time we have to talk more about the school and your views on education. That's so key and critical. And since you have experience with the school in Senegal, we definitely want to highlight that. So you're going to come back again in the future?
Anytime you call me.
All right. Great. Great. Okay. Brothers and sisters, I hope that you enjoyed our sister P. Ray as much as I did. I know that we're coming upon the end of this show, brothers and sisters, but I want to remind you to please go to our website at Crow, www.croe.org, and go give us a call directly. Find out about what we do. 773-925-1600. Brothers and sisters, thank you so much for viewing. I leave you with the greetings of peace and paradise. Assalamu alaikum.